Memoirs of Leonora Christina, Princess and Daughter of Christian IV of Denmark, written during her imprisonment in the Blue Tower at Copenhagen between 1663 and 1685. Preface. In placing the present translation of Leonora Christina Ulfeldt's memoirs before the English reading public, a few words are due from the publishers in order to explain the relation between the edition and those which have been brought out in Denmark and in Germany. The original autograph manuscript of Leonora Christina's record of her sufferings in her prison, written between the years of 1674 and 1685, belongs to her descendant, the Austrian Count John Waldstein, and it was discovered only a few years ago. It was then at the desire of Count Waldstein, brought to Copenhagen by the Danish minister at Vienna, M. Falbe, in order that its authenticity might be thoroughly verified by comparison with documents preserved in the Danish archives and libraries, and known to be in the handwriting of the illustrious authoress. When the existence of this interesting recordings and literary relic has become known in Denmark, I desired to see it published was naturally expressed on all sides, and to this the noble owner most readily acceded. Thus, the first Danish edition came to light in 1869, promoted in every way by the Count Waldstein. The editor was Mr. Sophus Birkert Smith, assistant librarian of the University Library of Copenhagen, which enriched the edition with a historical introduction and copious notes. A second Danish edition appeared a few months later, and in 1871 a German translation of the memoir was edited by M. Sigler with a new introduction and notes, founded partly on the first Danish edition, partly on other printed sources, to which were added extracts from some papers found in the family archives of Count Waldstein, and which were supposed to possess the interest of novelty. The applause with which this edition was received in Germany suggested the idea of an English version, and it was at first intended merely to translate Mr. Sigler's book into English. During the progress of the work, however, it was found preferable to adopt the second Danish edition as the basis of the English edition. The translation which had been made from Mr. Sigler's German has been carefully compared with the Danish original so as to remove any defects arising from the use of the German translation and give it the same value as a translation made direct from the Danish. A new introduction and notes have been added for which a Danish editor, Mr. Birkert Smith, has supplied the materials, and instead of the fragments of Ulfeldt's apology and of an extract from Leonora Christina's autobiography found in the German edition, a complete translation of the autobiography to the point where Leonora's memoir of her sufferings in prison takes up the thread of the narrative, has been inserted, made from the original French text recently published by Mr. S. Birkert Smith. As a matter of course, the preface of Count Waldstein, which appears in this edition, is the only prefixed to the Danish editions. The manuscript itself of the record of Leonora Christina's sufferings in prison was commenced in 1674 and was at first intended to commemorate only what had happened during the proceedings 10 years after her captivity. It was afterwards extended to embrace the whole period down to 1685 and subject to a revision which resulted in numerous additions and alterations. As however, these do not seem to have been properly worked in by the authoress herself, the memoir is here rendered, as in the Danish edition, in its original, more perfect shape, and the subsequent alterations made the subject of footnotes. Preface to the Danish edition. When in the summer of 1858 I visited the graves of my Danish ancestors of the family of Ulfeldt in the little village church of Gwendrup near the castle of Egeskov on the island of Finn, I resolved to honor the memory of my pious ancestress Leonora Christina and thus fulfill the duty of a descendant by publishing this autograph manuscript which had come to me amongst the heirlooms left by my father. It is well known that the last male representative of the family of Ulfeldt, the Chancellor of the Court and Realm of Her Majesty the Empress Maria Theresia had only two daughters. One of them, Elizabeth, married George Christian, Count Wallenstein, while the younger married Count Thun. Out of special affection for her younger son, Emmanuel, my late father, my grandmother bequeathed all of that referred to the Ulfelds to him, and the manuscript, which I now, in consequence of requests from various quarters, also from high places, give to publicity by the learned assistance of Mr. Sophus Birkett Smith, thus came to me through direct descent from her father. Corfield, Count of Ulfeld, of the Holy Roman Empire, Lord of the Lordships Kölz, Jenikau, Hofkatzow, Breulich, Osterlotz, and Fief Zindlich, Knight of the Golden Fleece, first treasurer of hereditary lands in Bohemia, ambassador of the Ottoman Porte, afterwards Chancellor of the Court and the Empire, sworn private counselor and first Lord Steward of His Imperial and Royal Majesty Carolus the Sixth, as well of His Imperial Roman and Royal Majesty of Hungary, Bohemia, and etc. We added the highly honored paternal guide of Her Majesty the Queen, Empress Maria Theresia, of glorious memory during the first year of her government, until the time when the gifted Prince Kaunitz, whose genius sometimes even was too much for this morally noble lady, became her successor. I possess more than 11 imposing, closely written folio volumes, which contain the manuscripts of the Chancellor of the Empire, his negotiations with the Supreme Porte, afterwards with the States General of the Netherlands, as well as the ministerial protocols from the whole time that he held the office of Imperial Chancellor, all of which prove his great industry and love order, while the original letters and annotations of his exalted mistress, which are inserted in the same volumes, testify to the sincere, almost childlike confidence with which she honored him. But this steady and circumspect statesman was the direct grandson of the restless and proud Corfitz, first Count of Ulfeld of the Roman Empire, High Steward of the Realm in Denmark, and of his devoted and gifted wife, Leonora Christina, through their son, Leo, Imperial Count Ulfeld, Privy Councillor, Field Marshal and Viceroy in Catalonia of the Emperor Karl VI, and his wife, upon Countess of Zinzendorf. I preserved, therefore, with great care this manuscript, as well as all other relics and little objects which had belonged to my Danish ancestress, whose exalted character and sufferings are so highly calculated to inspire sympathy, interest, and reverence. Amongst these objects are several writings, such as fragments of poems, prayers, needlework executed in prison, some embroidered with hair of a fair color, a christening robe with cap worked in gold, probably used at the christening of her children, a very fine amulet of Christian IV in blue enamel, and many portraits, amongst others, the original picture in oil of which a copy precedes the title page. Considering that the manuscript has been handed down directly from my ancestors from generation to generation direct line, I could not personally have any doubt to its genuineness. Nevertheless, I yielded to the suggestions of others in order to have the authenticity of the manuscript thoroughly tested. In what way this was done will be seen from the introduction of the editor. Through the final verdict of history may not yet have been given on Corfield Ulfeld yet, Tempus omnia sanat, your omnius pila, which was to perpetuate the memory of his crime into eternity, has been put aside as rubbish and left to oblivion. Noble in forgetting and pardoning, the great nation of the Norse has given a bright example of those who still refuse to grant to Albert, Duke of Friedland, the great general who saved the empire from the danger that threatened it from the Norse. The place which this hero ought to occupy in the Valhalla at Vienna. But as to the fiery temper of Corfitz and the mysterious spring which governed the deeds and thoughts of mankind, it may be permitted to me, his descendant, to cherish the belief, which is almost strengthened into a conviction, that a woman so highly gifted of so noble sentiments as Leonora appears to us, would never have been able to cling with a love so true and so adoring through all the changes of life to a man who was unworthy of it. Memoirs of Leonora Christina Introductions. Amongst the women celebrated in history, Leonora Christina, the heroine, as well as the authoress of the memoirs, which form the subject of this volume, occupies a conspicuous place as one of the noblest examples of every womanly virtue and accomplishment, displayed under the most trying vicissitudes of fortune. Born the daughter of a king, married to one of the ablest statesmen of this time, destined as it seemed to shine in the undisturbed illustre of position and great qualities, she had to spend nearly 22 years in prison, in the forced company, more cruel to her than solitary confinement, of male and female gaolers of the lowest order, and for a long time deprived of every means of rendering herself independent of these surroundings by intellectual occupation. She had to suffer alone and innocently for her husband's crimes. Whatever these were, she had no part in them, and she endured prosecution because she would not forsake him in his misfortune. Leonora Christina was the victim of despotism guided by personal animosity, and she submitted with a Christian meekness and forbearance which would be admirable in any way, but which her exalted station and her great mental qualities bring out in doubly strong relief. It is to these circumstances which render the fate of Leonora so truly tragic, as well as to the fact that we have her own authentic and trustworthy account before us, that the principal charm of this record is due. Besides this, it affords many incidental glimpses of the customs and habits of the time, nor is it without its purely historical interest. Leonora and her husband, Kofitz Ulfeld, were ultimately connected with the principal political events in the north of Europe at their time. Even the more minute circumstances of their life have, therefore, a certain interest. No wonder that the history of this illustrious couple has formed and still forms for them both of laborious scientific researches and of poetical composition. Amongst the latter, we may here mention in passing a well-known novel by Rousseau de la Valette, because it has had the undeserved honor of being treated by modern writer as a historical source to the great detriment of his composition. Documents which have originated from these two personages are of course of great value. Besides letters and public documents, there exist several accounts written by both Kofitz Ulfeld and Leonora, referring to their own life and actions. Ulfeld published in 1652 a defense of his political conduct, and composed shortly before his death another commonly called Apology of Ulfeld, which has not yet been printed entirely, but of which an extract was published in 1695, in the supplement of the English edition of Rousseau de la Valette's book. Some extracts from an incomplete copy discovered by Count Wallstein in 1870 in the family archives of the castle of Palotta were published with the German edition of Leonora's Problems Memoir. Complete copies exist in Copenhagen and elsewhere. Leonora Christina, who was an accomplished writer, has composed at least 4 partial accounts of her own life, one of them referring to a journey in 1656, to be mentioned hereafter, has been printed long ago, of another which treated of her and Ulfeld's imprisonment at Bornholm. No copy has yet been discovered. The third is her autobiography, carried down to 1673, of which an English version follows this introduction. It was written in the Blue Tower in the form of a letter to the Danish equitarian Otto Sperling Jr., who wished to make use of it for his work, De Feminitis Doctis. About a century ago, a so-called autobiography of Leonora was published in Copenhagen, but it was easily provided to be forgery. In fact, the original of her own work existed in the Danish archives and had been described by the historian Andreas Hoyer. It has now been lost. It is supposed in the fire which destroyed the castle of Christiansborg in 1794. But a complete copy exists in Copenhagen, as well as several extracts in Latin. Another short extract in French belongs to Count Waldstein. Finally, Leonora Christina wrote the memoir of her sufferings in the prison of the Blue Tower from 1663 to 1685, of which existence was unknown until discovered by Count Waldstein and given to the public in the manner indicated in the preface. In introducing these memoirs to the English public, a short sketch of the historical events and the persons to whom they refer may not be unwelcome, particularly as Leonora herself touches only very lightly on them and principally describes her own personal life. Leonora Christina was a daughter of King Christian IV of Denmark and Kirstine Munk. His queen Anne Catherine, born a princess of Brandenburg, died in 1612, leaving three princes. Four other children died early, and in 1615 the king contracted a morganatic marriage with Christina Munk, a lady of an ancient and illustrious noble family. Leonora was born July 18, 1621 at the castle of Frederiksborg, so well known to all who have visited Denmark, which the king had built 20 miles north of Copenhagen in a beautiful part of the country, surrounded by smiling lakes and extended forests. But little is known of her childhood beyond what she tells herself in her autobiography. Already in her 8th year, she was promised to her future husband, Corfitz Ulfeld, and in 1636, the wedding was celebrated with great splendor. Leonora being the 15th years old, the family of Ulfeld has been known since the close of the 14th century. Corfitz's father had been chancellor of the realm and somewhat increased the family possessions through his sold the ancient seat of the family, Ultensfeldholm in Finn, to Lady Ellen Marsvin, Kirstin Munk's mother. He had 17 children, of whom Corfitz was the 7th, and so far Leonora made only a poor marriage, but her husband's great talents and greater ambition made up for his defect. Of his young, nothing is known with any certainty, except that he travelled abroad, as other young noblemen of this time, studied at Padua and acquired considerable proficiency in foreign languages. He became a favorite of Christian IV, at whose court he had every opportunity for displaying his social talents. At the marriage of the elected successor to the throne, the king's eldest son Christian, with the Princess Magdalene Sibylle of Saxony in 1634, Corfitz Ulfeld acted as Marechal to the special ambassador Count Davout, whom Louis XIII had sent to Copenhagen on that occasion, in which situation Ulfeld won golden opinions, and he was one of the 12 noblemen whom the king on the wedding day made Knights of the Elephant. After a visit to Paris in 1635, in order to be cured of a woman in the leg, wound in the leg, which the Danish physicians could not heal, he obtained the sanctions of the king for his own marriage with Leonora, which was solemnized at the castle of Copenhagen on October 9, 1636, with as much splendor as those of the princes and princesses. Leonora was a favorite daughter of Christian IV, and as far as royal favors could ensure happiness, it might be said to be in store for the newly married pair. As we have stated, Ulfeld was a poor nobleman, and it is characteristic of them both that one of her first acts was to ask him about his debts, which he could not have incurred living as he had done, and to pay them by selling her jewels and ornaments to the amount of $36,000 or more than $7,000 in English money, then a very large sum. But the king's favor soon procured him what he wanted. He was made a member of the Great Council, governor of Copenhagen, and chancellor of the Exchequer. He executed several diplomatic missions satisfactorily, and when in 1641 he was sent to Vienna as a special ambassador, the Emperor of Germany, Ferdinand III, made him a count of the German Empire. Finally, in 1643, he was made Lord High Steward of Denmark, the highest dignity of most responsible office in the kingdom. He was now at the summit of power and influence, and if he had used his talents and opportunities in the interests of his country, he might have earned the everlasting gratitude of his king and his people. But he was not a great man, though he was a clever and ambitious man. He accumulated enormous wealth, bought extensive landed estates, spent considerable sums in purchasing jewels and costly furniture, and lived in a splendid style. But it was all at the cost of the country. In order to enrich himself, he struck base coin, which afterwards officially reduced its proper value 8% below the nominal value, and used probably other unlawful means for the purpose, while the crown was its greatest need of money. At the same time, he neglected the defense of the country in a shameful manner, and when the Swedish government in December 1643 suddenly ordered its army, which stood in Germany, engaged into the 30 Years' War to attack Denmark without any warning, there were no means of stopping its victorious progress. In vain, the veteran king collected a few vessels and compelled the far more numerous Swedish fleet to fly after a furious battle near Femern, where he himself received 23 wounds, and where two of Ulfeldt's brothers fell fighting at his side. There was no army in the land because Corfitz, at the head of the nobility, had refused the king the necessary supplies. And also the peace, which Ulfeldt concluded with Sweden and Holland at Brömsebo in 1645, might have been still more disastrous than it was if the negotiation had been entrusted to less skillful hands. Yet there was too much truth in the reproachful words of the king when, after ratifying entreaties, he tossed them to Corfitz, saying, "There you have them, such as you have made them." From this time the king began to lose his confidence in Ulfeldt, though the latter still retained his important offices. In the following year he went to Holland and to France on a diplomatic mission, on which occasion he was accompanied by Leonora. Everywhere the personal qualities, their relationship to the sovereign, and the splendor of their appearance procured them the greatest attention and the most flattering reception. While at The Hague, Leonora gave birth to a son, whom the States General offered to grant a pension for life of 1,000 florins, which, however, Ulfeldt wisely refused. In Paris they were loaded with presents. In the memoirs of Madame Langlois de Motteville on the history of Anna of Austria, there is a striking recital of the appearance and the reception of Ulfeldt and Leonora at the French court. On the way home, Leonora took an opportunity of making a short trip to London, which capital she wished to see, while her husband waited for her in the Netherlands. If, however, this journey brought Ulfeldt and his wife honors and presents on the part of foreigners, it did not give satisfaction at home. The diplomatic results of the mission were not what the king had hoped, and he even refused to receive Ulfeldt on his return. Soon the turning point in his career arrived. 1648, King Christian IV died under circumstances which for a short time concentrated extraordinary power in Ulfeldt's hands, but of which he did not make a wise use. Denmark was then still an elective monarchy, and the nobles had availed themselves of this and other circumstances to freely themselves from all burden, and all the same time to deprive both the crown and the other estates of the constitutional rights to a very great extent. All political power was virtually vested in the Council of the Realm, which consisted exclusively of nobles, and there remained for the kings next to nothing, except a general supervision of the administration and the nomination of the ministers. Every successive king had been obliged to purchase his election by fresh concessions to the nobles, and the sovereign was little more than the president of an aristocratic republic. Christian IV had caused his eldest son Christian to be elected successor in his own lifetime. But this prince died in 1647, and when the king himself died in 1648, the throne was vacant. As Lord High Steward, Ulfeldt became president of the regency and could exercise great influence on the election. He did not exert himself to bring this about very quickly, but there is no ground for believing that he mediated the election either of himself or of his brother-in-law, Count Valdemar, as some have suggested. The children of Christine Monk, being the offspring of a morganatic marriage, had not, of course, equal rank with princes and princesses, but in Christian IV's lifetime they received the same honors, and Ulfeld made use of the interregnum to obtain the passage of decree by the council, according them rank and honors equal with the princes of the royal house. But as the nobles were in no wise bound to choose a prince of the same family, or even a prince at all, this decree cannot be interpreted as evidence of a design to promote the election of Count Valdemar. The overtures of the Duke of Gottorp, who attempted to bribe Ulfeld to support his candidature, were refused by him, at least according to his own statement, but Ulfeld did make use of his position to extort a more complete surrender of the royal power into the hands of the nobility than any king had yet submitted to, and the new King Frederick III was compelled to promise, among other things, to fill up any vacancy amongst the ministers with one out of the three candidates proposed by the Council of the Realm. The new King Frederick III, Christian IV's second son, had never been friendly to Ulfeld. This last action of the High Steward did not improve the feelings with which he regarded him, and when the coronation has taken place for which Ulfeld advanced the money, he expressed his thoughts at the banquet in the words, "Corfitz, you have today bound my hands. Who knows who can bind yours in return?" The new queen, a Saxon princess, hated Ulfeld and the children of Christine Monk on account of their pretensions, particularly Leonora Christina, whose beauty and talent she heartily envied. Nevertheless, Ulfeld retained his high offices to some time, and in 1647 he went again to Holland on a diplomatic mission, accompanied by his wife. It is remarkable that the question which formed the principal subject of the negotiation on that occasion was one which had found its proper solution only in our days, namely that of a redemption of the sound dues. This impact levied by the Danish crown on all vessels passing the sound weighed heavily on the shipping interest and frequently caused disagreement between Denmark and the governments mostly interested in the Baltic trade, particularly Sweden and the Dutch Republic. It was with a special regard to the sound dues that the Dutch government was constantly interfering in the politics of the North with a view of preventing Denmark becoming too powerful, for which purpose it was always fomented discord between Denmark and Sweden, siding now with the one or the other, but rather favoring the design of Sweden to conquer the ancient Danish provinces Kane, which were east of the Sound and which now actually belonged to Sweden. Corfitz Ulfeld calculated that if the Dutch could be satisfied on the point of the sound dues, the unfavorable interference might be got rid of, and for this purpose he proposed to substitute any annual payment by the Dutch government for the payment of the dues by the individual ships. Christian IV had never assented to this idea, and of course the better course would have been the one adopted in 1857, namely the redemption of the dues by all states at once for a proportionate consideration paid once for all. Still, the leading thought was true and worthy of great statesmen. Ulfeld concluded a treaty with Holland according to his views, but it met with no favor at Copenhagen, and on his return he found that in his absence measures had been taken to restrict his great power. His conduct of affairs was freely criticized, and his enemies had been caused the nomination of a committee to investigate his past administration, more particularly his finances measures. At the same time, the new court refused Leonora Christina and the other children of Christine Monk the princely honors which they had here to enjoy. Amongst other marks of distinction, Christian IV had granted his wife and her children the title of counts and countesses of Schleswig and Holstein, but Frederick III declined to acknowledge it, Also, it could have no political importance, buying nothing but an empty title, as neither Christine Munk nor her children had anything whatever to do with either of these principalities. Ulfeld would not suffer himself to be it were driven from high position by these indications of disfavor on part of the king and the queen. The latter was really the moving spirit of it all, but he resolved to show his annoyance by not counting going to court, where his wife did now not receive the usual honors. This conduct only served to embroider those who desired to oust him from his lucrative office, not because they were better patriots, but because they hoped to succeed him. For this purpose, a false accusation was brought against Ulfeld and Leonora Christina, to the effect that they had the intention of poisoning the king and the queen. Information on this plot was given to the queen personally by a certain Dina Vinhovers, a widow of questionable reputation, who declared that she had an illicit connection with Ulfeld, and that she had heard a conversation on the subject between Corfitz Ulfeld and Leonora when on a clandestine visit in the High Steward's house. She was prompted by a certain Walter, originally a son of a wheelwright, who, by bravery in the war, had risen from the ranks to the position of a colonel, and who, in his turn, was evidently a tool in the hands of other parties. The information was graciously received at court, but Dina, who, as it seems, was a person of weak and unsound mind, secretly, without the knowledge of her employers, warned Ulfeld and Leonora of some impending danger, thus creating a seemingly intractable confusion. At length, Ulfeld demanded a judicial investigation, which was once set on foot, but in which, of course, he occupied the position of a defendant on account of Dina's information. In the end, Dina was condemned to death and Walter was exiled, but the statements of the different persons implicated, and particularly of Dina herself at different times, were so conflicting that the matter was really never entirely cleared up. And Sir Ulfeld was absolved of all guilt. His enemies did their best in order that some suspicion might remain. If Ulfeld had been wise, he might probably have turned this whole affair to his own advantage, but he missed the opportunity. Utterly absurd as the accusation was, he seems to have felt very keenly the change of his position, and on advice of Leonora, who did not doubt that some other expedient would be tried by his enemies, and perhaps with more success, he resolved to leave Denmark altogether. After having sent away the most valuable part of his furniture and movable property, and placed abroad his amassed capital, he left Copenhagen secretly and at night on July 14, 1651, 3 days after the execution of Diana. The gates of the fortress were closed at a certain hour every evening, but he had a key made for the eastern gate, and ere sunrise he and Leonora, who was disguised as a valet, were on board a vessel on their way to Holland. The consequences of this impolitical fight were most disastrous. He had not laid down his high offices, much less rendered any account of administration. Nothing was more natural than to suppose that he wished to avoid an investigation. A few weeks later, a royal summons was issued, calling upon him to appear at the next meeting of the Diet and answer for his conduct. His offices and the fiefs with which he had been beneficed were given to others, and an embargo was laid on his landed estates. Leonora Christina describes in her autobiography how Ulfeld meanwhile first went to Holland and then to Sweden, where Queen Christina, who certainly was not favorably disposed to Denmark, received Ulfeld with marked distinction and promised him her protection. But she does not tell how Ulfeld her used every opportunity for stirring up enmity against Denmark, both in Sweden itself and in other countries, though his ambassadors had tried to bring over to his ideas. On the painful subject, there can be no doubt, after the publication of so many authentic state papers of the time, amongst which may mention the reports of Whitelock, the envoy of Cromwell, to whom Ulfeld represented that Denmark was too weak to resist an attack, and that the British government might easily obtain the abolition of the Sound Dues by war. It seems, however, as if Ulfeld did all this merely to terrify the Danish king into a reconciliation with him on terms honorable and advantageous to the voluntarily exiled magnate. Representations were severely times made with such a view by the Swedish government, and in 1656 Leonora Christina herself undertook a journey to Copenhagen in order to arrange the matter, but the Danish government were inacceptable to such attempts. This attitude was intelligible enough, for not only had Ulf left Denmark in the most uncertain manner, but in 1652 he published in Stralsund a defense against the accusations of which he had been the subject, full of gross insults against the king. And in the following year he had issued an insolent protest against the royal summons to appear and defend himself before the diet, declaring himself a Swedish subject. But above all, the influence of the queen was too great to allow of any arrangement with Ulfeld. The king was entirely led by her. She, from her German home, was filled with the most extravagant ideas of absolute despotism and hated the free speech and the independent spirit prevailing among the Danish nobility, of which Ulfeld, in that respect, was a true type. Leonora Christina was compelled to return in 1656 without even seeing the king and as a fugitive. It is of this journey that she has given a Danish account besides the description in the autobiography. It may be questioned whether it would not have been wise, if possible, to conciliate this dangerous man, but at any rate it was not done, and Ulfeld was, no doubt, still more exasperated. Queen Christina had then resigned, and her successor, Carl Gustav, shortly after engaged in a war in Poland. The Danish government, foolishly overrating its strength, took the opportunity for declaring war against Sweden in the hope of regaining some of the territory lost in 1645. But Carl Gustav, well knowing that the Poles could not carry the war into Sweden, immediately turned his whole force against Denmark, but where he met with the next to no resistance. Ulfeld was then living at Bars in Pomerania, an estate which he held in mortgage for large sums of money advanced to the Swedish government. Carl Gustav summoned Ulfeld to follow him, and Ulfeld obeyed the summons against the advice of Leonora Christina, who certainly did not desire her native country to be punished for the wrongs, if such were inflicted upon her by the court. The war had begun, declared in the 1st of June 1657. In August, Ulfeld issued a proclamation to the nobility in Jutland, calling on them to transfer their allegiance to the Swedish king. In the subsequent winter, a most unusually severe frost enabled the Swedish army to cross the sounds and belts on the ice, Ulfeld assisting its progress by persuading the commander of the fortress of Naskos to surrender without resistance, and in February the Danish government had to accept such conditions of peace as could be obtained from the Swedish king, who had halted a couple of days' march from Copenhagen. By this peace, Denmark surrendered all her provinces to the east of the Sound, which constituted one-third of the ancient Danish territory, and which have ever since belonged to Sweden, besides her fleet, etc. But the greatest humiliation was the negotiation of the Swedish side was entrusted to Ulfeld, who did not fail to extort from the Danish crown the utmost that the neutral powers would allow. For himself, he obtained restitution of his estates, freedom to live in Denmark unmolested, and large indemnity for loss of income of his estates since his fight in 1651. The King of Sweden also rewarded him with the title of Count of Salzburg and with considerable estates in the provinces recently wrested from Denmark. Ulfeld himself went to reside at Malmö, the principal town in Skåne, situated on the Sound, just opposite Copenhagen. Here was Champion Leonora Christina. In her autobiography, Leonora does not touch on the incidents of the war, but she describes how her anxiety for her husband's safety did not allow her to remain quietly at Bars, and how she afterwards called to her mother's sickbed, which she had to leave in order to nurse her husband, who fell ill at Malmö. We may here state that Christina Munk had fallen into disgrace when Leonora was still a child on account of her flagrant infidelity to the king. Her paramour, being a German Count of Solms, Christine Munk left the court voluntarily in 1629, shortly after the birth of a child whom the king would not acknowledge as his own. After having stayed with her mother for a short time, she took up residence at an old manor of Bolla in North Jutland, where she remained until her death in 1658. Various attempts were made to reconcile Christian IV to her, but he steadily refused, and with very good reason. He was doubtless well aware that Christine Munk, as recently published diplomatic document proof, had betrayed his political secrets to Gustav Adolf, the King of Sweden, and he considered her presence at court very dangerous. Her son-in-law was now openly in the service of another Swedish king, but the friendship between them was not of long duration. Ulf at first incurred the displeasure of Carl Gustav by heading the opposition of the nobility in the newly acquired provinces against imposts laid them by the Swedish king, to which they had not been liable under Danish rule. Then other causes of disagreement arose, Carl Gustav regretting that he had concluded a peace when in all probability he might have conquered the whole of Denmark, recommenced her war, and laid siege to Copenhagen. But the Danish people now rose as one man. Foreign assistance was obtained, the Swedes were everywhere beaten, and if the Dutch, who were bound by treaty to assist Denmark, had not refused the cooperation in transferring the Danish troops across the Sound, all the lost provinces might easily have been regained. The inhabitants in some of these provinces also rose against the new rulers. Amongst others, the citizens of Malmö, where Ulfeld in the time resided, entered into a conspiracy to throw off the Swedish dominion. But it was betrayed, and Ulfeld was indicated as one of the principal instigators. Also, he himself had accepted the forced homage to the Swedish king as his deputy. Very probably he had thought that if he took a part in the rising, he might, if this were successful, returning to Denmark, having as it were thus wiped out his former crimes, but having also shown his countrymen what a terrible foe he could be. As it was, Denmark was prevented by her own allies from regaining her losses, and Ulfeld was placed in custody in Malmö by order of Carl Gustaf, in order that his conduct might be subject to rigorous examination. Ulfeld was then, apparently, seized with a remarkable malady, a kind of apoplexy, depriving him of speech, and Leonora conducted his defense. She worked through lengthy, vigorous, and skillful surprise to the charges, which still exist in the originals. He was acquitted, or rather escaped, by verdict of not proven, but as conscience makes coward, he contrived to escape before the verdict was given. Leonora Christina transcribes all this in her autobiography, according to which Ulfeld was to go to Lübeck, which she would go to Copenhagen and try to put matters straight there. Ulfeld, however, changed his plans without her knowledge, and also repaired to Copenhagen, where they were both arrested and sent to the castle of Hammerhus on the island of Bornholm in the Baltic, an ancient fortress, now a picturesque ruin, perched at the edge of the perpendicular rocks, overhanging the sea and almost surrounded by it. The autobiography relates circumstantially and no doubt truthfully the cruel treatment to which they were here subject by the governor and Major General Fuchs. After desperate attempt at escape, they were still more rigorously guarded, and at the length they had to purchase their liberty by surrendering the whole of their property, excepting one estate in Fien. Ulfeld had to make the most humble apologies and to promise not to leave the island of Fien, where this estate was situated, without special permission. He was also compelled to renounce on the part of his wife the title of Countess of Schleswig-Holstein, which Frederick III had never acknowledged. She never made use of the title afterwards, nor is she generally known by it in history. Kofitz Ulfeld's being a count of the German Empire, of course Leonora and the children weren't remain counts and countesses of Ulfeld. This compromise was effected in 1661.